Listening Library presents The Piper's Promise by Leah Cypess. Read for you by Elena Rey. To David. Prologue. I know what you've heard about my brother. That he's evil. That he's a liar and a thief. That he has terrible taste in clothing. That he played his magic pipe and stole the children of Hamelin, leading them to a faraway land where their parents couldn't follow. All those things are sort of true, but they're also not true, not the way you think they are. The story of the Pied Piper did happen the way you heard it. The town of Hamelin was infested with rats until a stranger in colorful clothes offered to take care of the problem. His price was high, but the mayor was desperate and agreed. So the boy took out his pipe and played it, and all the rats were drawn to the sound. He led them to the river and then into the river, and they followed the music to their deaths.
"Sorry," the mayor said the next day. "Your fee is criminally high. But since I'm so glad to be rid of the rats, I won't throw you in jail. I'll simply pay you a fair price and send you on your way."
He probably thought he was so clever. After all, it wasn't as if the piper could bring the rats back. And the piper didn't. He waited until the next morning, and then he played a different tune on his pipe. This time, it wasn't rats who came streaming to the music. It was the town's children, dancing and laughing, pushing and fighting each other in their eagerness to be first. The Pied Piper led them down the road from Hamelin and right into the side of the mountain, and their parents never saw them again. That's how the story ends in every version I've heard. Some mention a few children who got left behind because they were deaf or blind or had trouble walking. Others don't. All agree, however, that the people of Hamelin lost their children forever because they refused to pay the piper. And that's how the story should end. That's the lesson people need to learn. Don't try to cheat one of the fae. It never ends well. But you haven't heard about me, have you? In the story your parents tell, my brother is the villain and the townspeople his innocent victims. Your parents are smart. There's a good reason they don't tell you about me. Because once I walked into Hamelin, the story got a lot more complicated. 1. The parents were grieving, and their grief was terrible to bear, both because of the depth and sharpness of their sadness, and because I knew that if anything horrible ever happened to me or Tom, our mother would never grieve for us that way. I wasn't sure she would grieve for us at all. "Love is a burden," Tom told me once, that time when I almost got eaten by a sea serpent, and our mother laughed as she told the Fae Court about it. Tom had been the one to save me, and then to hold me tight as I coughed up water. But when I came to him sobbing over our mother's lack of caring, he had pressed his lips together impatiently. "The other side of love is pain." I saw that pain now as I walked through the shabby gray streets of Hamelin. It leaked from every window in this small, dusty town, glared from every tear-streaked face that watched me pass. I understood that grief. For weeks now, I had been missing my brother, a constant empty ache under my heart. I knew how powerful that anguish was, because it had led me to do the unthinkable, to leave the realms by myself and come to the human world to find him. And I would find him. I would. No matter what had happened to him, no matter what he had done, I would find him and we would be together again. But I had never imagined that I was going to find this. Not my brother, but the pain he had left behind. And the only thing that made it bearable was the determination I clung to. I can fix this. I didn't know for sure if that was true, But I forced myself to believe it because there was no other way I could have made it down that eerily silent street, up the stairs of the grandest house in town, and into the mayor's office. The mayor's office was actually the front room of his house, which says a lot about how often Hamelin's yearly elections resulted in a change of mayor. Mayor Herman, I'd been told, had been the mayor for over 20 years. It would probably help if someone occasionally ran against him, but since no one ever did, the ballots generally had two choices: Herman Jeremson and somebody else if we can find someone qualified and willing, which is unlikely. Written on the ballot, just like that. I'd seen one stuck under a grimy wellstone, left over from the last election. Not the most democratic of places, Hamelin. Not that it would have helped much if it had been. The mayor's office reeked of stale tobacco, and his face shone with sweat. He sat upright in his brown leather chair, brow furrowed as if he was in control of the situation. But I, of all people, could recognize tightly controlled fear. He had been the one who hired my brother as a rat catcher. He had been the one who refused to pay the exorbitant fee. Any moment now, the people's grief would turn into anger, and they would remember who was responsible for the tragedy that had overtaken their town. They would be wrong. My brother had come for their children, and he would have found a way to take them even if Hamelin had a smart and honest mayor. But nobody knew that except me, and I certainly wasn't about to tell Mayor Herman. The mayor looked up as I entered. He drew in his breath, and I wondered if he recognized something in me that reminded him of Tom. If he was remembering the last time a lanky, dark-haired child had walked into his office and offered to solve his problems. I hope not, but I had to be careful, just in case. Mayor Herman, I said and curtsied. His eyes widened in astonishment, from which I gathered that it was not customary to curtsy to mayors. Human etiquette rules were so confusing. I am here to help you get Hamelin's children back.
Are you?
He sat back, regarding me with sharp blue eyes.
And what payment will you ask in return?
I had expected either joy or disbelief. I knew then that something was wrong, but I couldn't think fast enough to change my plan. No payment. I only want to make sure the children are unharmed. Can you tell me which way they went? The mayor leaned forward as if listening, but his eyes flicked to the door behind me. Too late, I realized what was happening. I turned, but not fast enough. Two men burst into the room. One had a bristling black beard that stuck straight out from his chin. The other, a large furry mustache that looked like it had been glued crookedly to his face. Before I could move, the man with the mustache had my arms pinned behind my back. I tried to twist free, but the bearded man grabbed my right arm and snapped a thick iron band around my wrist. After that, the only thing I could do was scream. I did scream, at the top of my lungs. Of course, no one came to help me. The townspeople were not partial to mysterious strangers right now. The bearded man stepped away from me.
Should I slap her?
He asked.
To shut her up?
He sounded like he really wanted to. I gulped, silencing myself.
Good girl, the mayor said.
He came out from behind his desk and stood in front of me. The mustached man still had my arms pinned behind me, and the bearded one glowered at me from beside the mayor. Each was nearly twice my height, but the mayor still made sure to leave several yards between him and me. It was nice to have a reputation. It would have been even nicer if I deserved that reputation. I snarled at the mayor. He flinched, then puffed his chest out. Too late. I had seen the flinch, and so had his hairy-faced henchman.
You will get us our children back, he said. And I'll give you nothing in return except your worthless life.
From the way the bearded man looked at him sideways, I knew the mayor had no intention of giving me that either.
Tell us where they are,
the mayor said.
I don't know,
I gasped. The iron band on my wrist hurt, not as much as it would have if I was fully fey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.